Okay, today we will start with session 3, that is steam boilers. So in previous sessions we have discussed on again the boilers and the different classifications of boilers and definition of boilers, and also we have seen one type of boiler, that is a Cochran boiler, that is a fire tube boiler. So in this session we will see again the what is Babcock and Wilcox boiler. So this Babcock and Wilcox boiler is a water tube boiler. So in the previous session we have seen the fire tube boiler, so fire tube boiler, and in this session we will see what is the water tube boiler. The example for water tube boiler is the Babcock and Wilcox boiler. So the water tube, in the previous session means fire tube means the fire is inside the tube and water is circulating around that tubes, so that is a fire tube boiler. The water tube boiler means is water is inside the tube and fire is around the tube. So this is called as water tube boiler. So the example for this is the Babcock and Wilcox boiler. So here in this figure, again the arrangement of this boiler is shown. So some of the parts or the components are similar to the previous boiler. So as far as the mountings and accessories are concerned, the working, the procedure is different, but the components, or you can say the boiler mountings and accessories are similar to the previous boiler. For example, the pressure gauge, water level indicator, feed check valve, safety valve, anti-priming pipe, so then stop valve, drum, these are all the mountings similar to the previous boiler. So the boiler working procedure changes and their efficiency and advantages and disadvantages were different, but the components fitted and the functioning of the components will remain the same. So in this boiler, once again there is a fire door will be there and there is a grate here. So the grate means it is a wheel chain arrangement. So on the wheels there is a chain is placed, on the top of the chain there is a fuel is moving. So that is, for example, coal is on the top of the chain and it is moving on the wheels. So it is feeded from the fire door, right? And the next one is a uptake header and a downtake header. So uptake header is somewhat above the above in height compared to the ground level, and the downtake header is just it is below the uptake header. So the functional of uptake and downtake header I'll explain in later stages. But now, so I have shown here there is a air in. So air in means when the fire, when the fuel is fed on the grate from the fire door, then the air is required for burning of the fuel. So that is air is that's why the air is sent from the bottom to the grate. So where the fire of the fuel takes place, so from that once the fuel burnt inside the grate, then again it liberates certain kind of heat, so that we called as flue gases. Those flue gases will move in the direction shown here in the curvature line like this. So right, and these are the things what I am showing right now. These are called as fire. These are called as a brickworks. So brick walls, I can call this as brick walls, right? And here there are two doors are provided wherein from these doors the man can enter inside the boiler and he may make some repair works in the boiler, right? So firstly, so when this water is fed through the feed check valve, the water enters the drum. So this drum, where the in the drum the water and steam both are stored in the drum, so definitely the differentiation is there in the difference is there in the steam and water. So the steam is stored in the upper portion and water is stored in the bottom portion. So this is because of density difference, right? So the water level indicator will show you the level of the water. So that is how much water is there in the boiler, so that you can see it through the water level indicator. And pressure gauge, the pressure is shown, so how much pressure is there in the water boiler, so based on that pressure you can operate the boiler. Then there is a safety valve. If the pressure exceeds the maximum pressure in the boiler, then the safety valve is opened. So from the safety valve the boiler you can make it safe. So then anti-priming pipe, you know the anti-priming pipe why it is used, because So in the steam, again, there are some water particles are present in the steam. So that, those water particles can be separated by using anti-priming pipe here. So then there is a stop hole. Through the stop hole, you can get the superheated steam for the further applications, right? There is a superheater tube here, superheater tube. This is called as a superheater tube, right? So now I'll explain the working of this Babcock's and Wilcox boiler. So initially the fuel that is called, it may be a coal is fed on the grate. So the fuel is fired. So once the fuel is fired, the flue gases are start flowing around these water tubes. So these water tubes are placed, one side is on the upper side, so other side is on the downside. So water is placed in the slanting position. So why this the water tubes are placed in the slanting position means at this point, the water enters this tube, upper header, it enters the upper header. So these tubes, these slant tubes are connected to the upper header. So again, it is connected to the downtake header. So the water enters from here and it flows in this direction, all the tubes. So while flowing in the tubes, so water is come across or it come in contact with the flue gases. So because of that flue gases, there is a heat transfer takes place from the flue gases to the water tubes. So when there is a heat exchange takes place, then definitely water gets converted into a steam. So that steam comes to the downtake header and it goes in the upper direction and it enters the drum and that steam stores in the drum. Right, so during that again, if the steam contains some water particles, so that due to the anti-priming pipe, the water particles get separated. Those water particles again enters in the superheated tubes. These superheated tubes are placed in the path of the flue gases. So again, in the flue gases, again there is a heat exchange takes place. Again, it gets converted into superheated steam, and that is used for the further applications from the stop valve. So this is the functioning of it, right? And now here, after burning the fuel, there is some ash or some impurities left out that is settled in the bottom side, and the smoke, that whatever the smoke is, that smoke enters the chimney, and from the chimney it goes to the atmosphere. So this is how it works, right? this is the function, and there is a buffle plates are placed here. Buffle plates, why it is placed here means it changes the direction of the flow of the flue gases. So when the flue gases are flowing, it should flow in the curvature manner like this. It is flow in the zigzag manner. When it flows in the zigzag manner, the time taken from to flow means the flue gases comes in contact with the water tubes more time. So the time of this flue gases in contact with the water tubes is more when this flows in the zigzag manner. So to flow the flue gases in the zigzag manner, in between we are placing the buffle plates there. Right, so this is what we are using, the buffle plates. Then the superheater tubes, I explained why the superheater is used. So this is the working of the Babcock's and Wilcox boiler. So the next we'll see what there are some merits and demerits. If you take any components of the mechanical, definitely it must have some the merits and demerits, right? So now we'll see what are the merits of this Babcock's and Wilcox boiler. So this boiler produces a steam up to 2000 to 40,000 kg per hour. Means this Babcock's and Wilcox boiler, it's a water tube boiler, it produces 2000 to 40,000 kg steam per hour. So it takes less space as compared to other boilers. Means the insulation space, whatever the space is required for this Babcock's and Wilcox boiler is small comparing to the other boilers. The boiler tubes can be easily replaced. The boiler tubes, whatever it is there, so that you can easily replace because there are two doors are provided there. So through that doors, the man can easily enter the boiler and he can replace that tubes. So why the boiler tubes are replaced easily? Because so the water is there. So in the water, there are some impurities are present. So those impurities are gets deposited on the walls of the water tube. So when it gets deposited, then the puts the pressure for the flow of the water. So that creates some the back pressure, which can leads to the explosion of the water tubes. So So if you want to avoid that, so you need to replace the boiler tubes again and again. So or so you can use it the purified water for the steam generation. So right. So the next, it is the only boiler that is used to produce huge quantity of heat in power plants. So this boiler can produce huge quantity of heat in power plants comparing to the other boilers. So in this boiler, the draught loss is low. The draught loss means, so after the flue gases, when it comes to the chimney, so it from the chimney it goes to the atmosphere. So when it goes to the atmosphere means, when the pressure difference in the chimney and atmosphere, the pressure difference must be there from the chimney to the atmosphere. The pressure in the chimney is more comparing to the atmosphere, then only so that smoke enters to the atmosphere. So that can be maintained, that can to happen when we do a particular draught. So that is the function is the draught. Draught means, so it helps in pushing the smoke from chimney to the atmosphere. So next one is, it can be easily repaired and cleaned. So this boiler can easily be repaired and it can be cleaned. Then there's the high overall efficiency. The efficiency of this boiler is more. Then the demerits. There are certain demerits for this boiler. One is a large maintenance cost. The maintenance cost is large here in this case. So it is not suitable for impure and sedimentary water. So as I told, it is not suitable because this is one of the disadvantages. I can say this is the demerits. Why? Because whenever if you use the water in the water tubes, then impurities or the sedimentary present in the water, it gets deposited on the walls of the water tubes. So that can create some back pressure. So that is the one of the disadvantages, the demerits of this boiler. A continuous feed water supply is needed to work. The continuous supply of water is required in this case. So that is one more the disadvantages or demerits of the boiler. Then advantages of water tube boiler over fire tube boiler. So as I said, water tube boiler and fire tube boiler. So I'll tell you what is water tube boiler. So the water flows inside the tube and the fire or flue gases are on that tube. Fire tube boiler means fire is inside the tube and water is flowing around that tube. So this is the difference between the water tube boiler and fire tube boiler. So now what is the advantages of water tube boiler over fire tube boiler? So it can generate the steam pressure up to 165 bar. Generate the pressure up to 165 bar. The pressure of the steam in this the Babcock and Wilcox boiler is 165 bar, which is not in the case of fire tube boiler. So it can generate the steam up to 450 tons per hour. So the steam generation from this boiler is around 450 tons per hour. Per hour. So how much steam is generated in this boiler is 450 tons. Less floor area is required for a given power. Right? This is already you have seen in the merits of this. And then higher overall efficiency is also is one of the merits. So that might be advantage of water tube boiler. Next, easy in transportation and erection. It is easy to transport if you want to install in some other places, in a new place. So the transportation and erection installation is very easy in the case of Babcock and Wilcox boiler. So it is preferred for widely fluctuating loads. So wherever the load is fluctuating in such cases, so this boiler is having some advantage. Water tube boiler is having more advantage. Fluctuating loads means at the customer end, at the consumer end, if the load varies, so easily that boiler can produce the steam so necessary for the compensating this fluctuating loads. Then the steam can be generated very rapidly. So the steam is generated very rapidly, very fastly in this case. The proportions of the furnace can be changed as per requirements because it is externally fixed. The proportions of the furnace you can change as per the requirements in this boiler. Suitable for large power plants. So this can be suitable for large power plants because the steam generation is more here. The steam can be generated rapidly. So for that reason, so this is suitable for the large power plants. Water can be circulated in a definite direction. So water in this boiler can be circulated in a definite direction. Why? Because the water tubes are fixed in a slanting position. So the positions are fixed so that the flowing of water is also in a particular direction. Bursting of one or two tubes does not affect the boiler function. If there are parallel water tubes are placed from the uptake header and lower take header, downtake header, so if any one tubes are burst, then there is no stopping in, you can continue the functioning of the boiler. There is no stopping of the boiler working. So that's one more advantages of it. Now we can see what are the differences between water tube boiler and fire tube boiler, right? So the first is, in the water tube boiler, the water flows inside the tube and the hot combustion gases flows outside the tube. So as I said, the water tube boiler, the name itself says water tube. Water is inside the tube and the hot combustion gases flows outside the tube, right? So in the case of fire tube boiler, the hot gases flows inside the tube and the water is outside the tube, right? So in water tube boiler, these are generally high pressure boiler ranging up to 70 to 100 bar, but in the case of fire tube boiler, these are generally low or medium pressure boiler up to 25 bar. Faster rate of steam production. The steam production is very fast in the case of water tube boiler, but it is lower rate in the case of fire tube boiler. More efficient and less efficient. So this is a more efficiency is more for the water tube boiler, but the efficiency is less in the case of fire tube boiler. These boilers are mostly externally fired. These are internally fired. The furnace is placed at one end of the boiler. Then this is suitable for large scale power plants. The water tube boilers are suitable for large scale power plants, but these fire tube boilers are suitable for small scale power plants. Since the operating pressure is high, the risk of explosion also high. Right, operating pressure in the case of water tube boiler is very high. Operating pressure, you can operate up to 165 bar. So if the pressure is high, then the risk of explosion is also high. But in the risk of explosion in the case of fire tube boiler is less, because the operating pressure is also very less, then occupies less floor space. So this water tube boiler occupies the less floor space, then this occupies the large floor space. So because of complexity, a skilled person is required to operate in the case of the water tube boiler. Because of complexity, there is a complex parts are there. So because of this complexity, the skilled labor or skilled person is required to operate, because he needs to understand what are the components there, how to operate those things safely following the boiler regulations. So to understand those things, the skilled labor is a must or a required in the case of water tube boiler, but that is not in the case of fire tube boiler. So less complex, less skilled labor or a skilled person is required here. Then easy to clean as it is externally fired. So since the water tube boilers are externally fired, so the cleaning is very easy in the case of water tube boiler. So, but that is not in the case of fire tube boiler. So it is difficult to clean as internally fired. The next one is easy to carry out maintenance. So in the case of water tube boiler, it is very easy to carry the maintenance, because two doors are provided. Man can enter inside the boiler, so he can maintain it very easily. But it is difficult to carry out maintenance in the case of fire tube boiler. So again, in the case of water tube boiler, since water flows inside the tube, treatment of water is necessary to prevent a deposit formation. So as I said, so the water is flowing inside the tubes. So because of that water, some impurities are present, some sedimentary particles are present in the water. So that may deposit on the walls of the tubes. So if it deposits, then definitely it hampers the working of the boiler. So that is possible. So to prevent the deposition formation, so the treatment of water is necessary. Treatment means we need to filter the water. So the filtered water, we can use it for the boiler, then we can avoid this deposition. So the treatment of water is not necessary in the case of fire tube boiler. The more environment friendly, so this water tube boiler is more environment friendly, but less environment friendly is fire tube boiler. So operating cost is high, the operating cost is less. So the operating cost in the case of the water tube boiler is high, but it is less in the case of fire tube boiler. So now we can look at the examples for water tube boiler. So the examples are Babcock and Wilcox boiler, the Stirling boiler, Lamont boiler, Benson boiler, and Loeffler boiler, right? So, but next, in this case, the examples are simple vertical boiler, Cochrane boiler, Lancashire boiler, Cornish boiler, and Scotch boiler, right? So, thank you. This is the end of the session 3. And in the next